Hello friends, welcome to this class on modular arithmetic. So modular arithmetic is something that we use in our daily life. Very simply, if we take a very simple example, if I have a train which is coming at 3 p.m. and it's delayed by 16 hours, if you have to find out what would be the new arrival time of this train, what you would do? Instead of adding 16 to 3, what you would do is first you will calculate what is the remainder when I divide 16 by 12, which is 4, and then you would say that the new arrival time of the train is 3 plus 4, which is equal to 7. We'll change this PM to AM, and I would say that the new arrival time of the train is 7 AM. So this is a fairly basic concept. We use it in our everyday life. In examinations, this concept of modular arithmetic is very useful. So it's used to very quickly solve problems involving large numbers. Right? So these problems involving these large numbers cannot be easily solved without using the concept of modular arithmetic. Even after we use this concept, right, even once we learn this concept of modular arithmetic, then it becomes easy for us to understand theorems like Euler's theorem, Fermat's theorem and Wilson's theorem. And these theorems would enable us to solve such problems. Instead of solving them in minutes, we can really solve them in seconds. So these theorems make our job even easier. So with that motivation, let's get started. Let's understand what do we mean by modular arithmetic. What does it really mean to express the numbers as remainders? What does it really mean? So here is the face of a clock. Right? In a clock, in a day, there are 12 hours. And once we go back to number 12, we always come to number 1. So there is no 13 here. So the face of the clock looks exactly the same when the time is 13 o'clock, because the hour hand of the clock just comes back to number 1. So if hypothetically there was a 13 o'clock, then this face of the clock would look exactly the same when the time is 1 o'clock and when the time is 13 o'clock. So in some sense, 13.00 is equivalent to 1.00 in this clock world. So in this clock world, 13 o'clock is same as 1 o'clock. So to understand it in better way, let's take a simple example. If I go forward 1 hour from 12 o'clock, I come to 1 o'clock. If I go forward 13 hours, I again come back to 1 o'clock. If I go forward 25 hours, so 25, 13, I again come back to 1 o'clock. So what does this mean? This means that on this face of the clock, in this clock world, 1 is equivalent to, right, or we say congruent to 13 and is also congruent to 25. This 1 is equivalent to, or formally we say congruent to 13 and 13 is congruent to 25. These three numbers are exactly equivalent, they are exactly congruent. Now let's try to define this more formally. So when we define this more formally, one small change that we make to the face of the clock is we replace 12 by number 0. So now the numbers here are exactly remainders of 12. Right? So 12 divided by 12 is 0. 13 divided by 12 leaves a remainder of 1. 14 divided by 12 leaves a remainder of 2, so on and so forth. So again, to define that congruence, once again, the way we write it is 13 is congruent to 1 mod 12. What does that mean? It means that when I divide 13 by 12, I get a remainder 1. And this is the way to write it. 13 is congruent to 1 mod 12. The way to think about it is, in this clock world, 13 is equivalent to 1. If from 0 or 12, I go forward 1 hour, or I go forward 13 hours, or I go forward 25 hours, my face of the clock would look exactly the same. It's one and the same thing. And the reason that happens is because all of these numbers leave a remainder 1 when divided by 12. And the way we speak it is 13 is congruent to 1 mod 12. So this is the concept of congruence. This is the formal notation for expressing congruence. Let's move a little more forward and see another example. So what happens with 7 days? If we are only interested in the days of the week, and I say that 0 is Sunday, 1 is Monday, then what happens? If I go forward one day from Sunday, I go to a Monday. If I go forward 8 days from a Sunday, then again I come to Monday. If I go forward 15 days from Sunday, I again come to Monday. So in this days of the week world, in this world, what do I see? I see that eight is congruent to 1 mod 7. If I go forward 8 days, I am moving only one day in the work week, in the days of the week thing. Similarly, 15 is congruent to 1 mod 7. And so on and so forth. And the thing to remember here is 7 divided by 8 gives me a remainder of 1, and 15 divided by 7 gives me a remainder of 1. And that is why these numbers, moving forward by 1, moving forward by 8, and moving forward by 15, are exactly equivalent, or they are congruent. Now, one important concept in congruence, especially in aptitude problems, this is used heavily. Right? One thing to realize here is, one trick essentially, this is a trick to realize, is there is a concept of going forward, and similarly there is a concept of going backwards. So we can move forwards as well as we can move backwards. When I move forward, right? For example, let's take this example of a clock. What can I say? 11 is congruent to 11 mod 12, because from 12, if I go forward 11 times, I come to 11. Right? So this is what this is saying, that 11 when divided by 12 gives me a remainder of 11. Another way to write the same thing is, what does that mean? It means that 11 is one shot. It is one shot of being fully divisible by 12. 11 is one shot of giving me a remainder, right? Of giving me a remainder of 0 when divided by 12. So if I add 1 to 11, I would get a number which is 12, which would give me a remainder 0 when divided by 12. So 11 is one shot of being fully divisible by 12. Similarly, on this face of the clock, if I go forward 23 hours, if I go forward 23 hours, then again I can say the same thing. If I go forward, either I can go forward 23 hours, I come to 11. Again, this 23 is one short of being fully divisible by 12. So, here we have introduced the concept of minus 1 or being one short, being too short of being fully divisible by the modulus right here. Now, there are certain properties of these congruences, and these properties, these properties are what make our life really simple. We will understand all of these properties using two simple sort of examples or using two numbers as our examples. All through we will use them. So, let us write them here. 9 is congruent to 2 mod 7 and 8 is congruent to 1 mod 7. So, we will keep this in mind. The first thing that we introduce is the addition and subtraction property of congruence. And what does that mean? It is very simple. What it means is I can simply add these congruences. So, I can say 9 is congruent to 2 mod 7 and 8 is congruent to 1 mod 7. Therefore, if I want to add these congruences, I can simply say 17 would be congruent to 3 mod 7, which means that 17 would leave a remainder of 3 when divided by 7. This is of course true. And the reason why this becomes true is, instead of writing everything as an algebraic expression, we would try to get some intuition of why this is true. So, 9, I can write it as 7 dot 1 plus 2, this is 9, okay, and I am trying to add it, plus 8, I can write it as 7 dot 1 plus 1. So, now of course, when I divide by 7, this term and this term won't leave a remainder, because these are factors of 7, these have 7 as factors. So, these really won't leave any remainders, and my remainder in this addition would come from here, which is 3 right here. So, what this is saying is, it is telling me that I can add the remainder of the addition is same as the addition of the remainders, right? Remainder of the addition, this is the addition, remainder of the addition is same as addition of the remainders, right? So, this is the property that we are trying to get to here. Similarly, for subtraction, subtraction would also work. Let's see if it works or not. So, instead of adding, if I subtract, then I get 9 minus 8 is 1 and 2 minus 1 is 1, which is trivially correct. And again, the reason why this works is very simple. 9 is 7 dot 2 plus 2, 7 dot 1, 7 into 1 plus 2 minus 7 into 1 plus 1. Of course, when I divide this by 7, then this term would be fully divisible, and I am left with 2 minus 1, which is equal to 1 as remainder. So, subtraction again works. And again, to think about it, to put it in words, what is this telling me? It is telling me that remainder of the subtraction, right, remainder of the subtraction is same thing as subtracting the remainders. This is what it is telling me. Let's take an example. Let's take a couple of examples and try to see how this property of addition and subtraction of congruences really simplifies our life. So, here we go. So, I'm been asked to find the last digit of this sum. One way is to calculate this sum, it is 8221, and say that the last digit is 1. Another way would be to really understand that last digit of any number is the remainder when that number is divided by 10. So last digit of this number is of course 3, which is also the remainder when 2403 is divided by 10. Okay, so we'll use this that property. And the second thing that we understood is we have been asked to find the remainder of this sum, which would be equal to nothing but sum of the remainders. So what would be the sum of the remainders? What is the remainder when this guy is divided by, this number is divided by 10? It is 3. The remainder here would be 1. The remainder here would be 8. The remainder here would be 9. So my answer is nothing but mod 10. In the mod 10 world, right, I have to simplify this number. This is nothing but 3 plus 9, 18, 21 mod 10. Of course, the 21 means that I am going in the circle of this mod 10 world 2 full times and then once more. Or in other words, the remainder when 21 is divided by 10 is 1. So this is congruent to 21 mod 10 is congruent to 1 mod 10, and therefore my remainder becomes 1. So the key here is to really reduce this sum of large numbers to sum of smaller numbers. And what is the property which enabled us to do that? The property which enabled us to do that, the thing that we realized as soon as we see this, is the remainder of this sum is nothing but sum of the remainders. That is what we are trying to do. Similarly, when I am being asked to find the remainder when this large number 60,002 is minus 601 is divided by 6, I am being asked to find the remainder of this thing. The first thing I realize is the remainder of this difference is nothing but the difference of the remainders. So what my answer here would be congruent to the remainder when 60,002 is divided by 6 is 2, and the remainder here would be 1. And this is nothing but 1. So the answer to this question becomes 1. And again, what we have done, think about it. What have we done here? This is the key step. This is the key step. The thing that we realized was that the remainder of this difference is nothing but the difference of the remainders. And this realization enabled us to simplify these large numbers into these smaller numbers. And this is the trick, my friends. This is the trick which enables us to solve really complicated looking problems very, very easily. This is the trick. Now, moving on. Let's look at the multiplication of congruences. So again, same thing. We'll use our two examples. 9 is congruent to 2 mod 7 and 8 is congruent to 1 mod 7. So we'll use the same example. And what are we trying to say? We are trying to say that, what is this property telling us? This property tells us that if I multiply these two congruences, I can simply multiply this side and I can simply multiply this side, these two numbers, and carry over the mod 7 as it is. And this has to be correct. This is correct. Okay. And you can check that it is correct. So one thing to notice here, just like addition, we multiplied only this and this numbers. We carried this thing downwards. We didn't change it at all. Right? And the necessary thing for us to apply this property, the necessary condition is both have to be the same mod. The mod, the number inside the mod has to be the same for both of these expressions. Let's look at this, why this is true. Let's try to get an intuitive understanding of why this is true. 9 is nothing but, we already did this, 7 plus 2 and 8. I can write it as 7 into 1 plus 1. If I expand this, what will I get? 7.7.1.1 plus 7 dot, this is 7.1, 7.1 both here, 2 plus 1 plus 2 into 1. So, I just expand this expression right here. If you notice, this term and this term is divisible by 7. 7 is a factor of both of these terms. So, of course, the remainder when this number is divided by 7 would be 2 into 1, right, which is the multiplication of these two numbers, or 2. So, we understand now that we can multiply congruences, and again, to put that in words, what does that mean? It means that multiplication of these two numbers, right, is same as when I multiply their remainders mod 7, right? Or in other words, the remainder of the multiplication is same, the remainder of the multiplication, remainder of 72 is the same as multiplication of the remainders. So, again, we will keep this in mind, this property in mind, and solve two problems. So, the first problem, again, it looks very, very complicated. It has very, very big numbers, and we have been asked to find the remainder of this large number divided by 3. Of course, if we were to really solve this and then divide by 3, it would take us a long time. So, we don't even want to go there. We quickly realize that the remainder when this large number is divided by 3 is nothing but the multiplications of the remainders that we get from 124 divided by 3, 134 divided by 3 and 23 divided by 3. In other words, the remainder, the answer to this question would be same as, it would be equivalent to, the remainder by 124 is divided by 3 is nothing but 1 into 134 divided by 3 gives me a remainder of 2 and 23 divided by 3 gives me a remainder of 2. Mod 3. So, again, what we have done? We have said that the remainder of this multiplication is same as the multiplication of individual remainders. It is really same in the mod 3 world. So, this is equivalent to 4 mod 3, which is equivalent to 1 mod 3. Because 4 divided by 3 gives me a remainder 1. So, I have just reduced it even further. So, the answer to this question would be 1. So, this large number when divided by 3 would give me a remainder of 1. So, now let's take a word problem and see how we can apply this concept in real world. So, let's say that I have 2 boxes. I have 44 boxes of chocolates. Each box has 113 chocolates, and I want to divide these large number of chocolates into dozens. So, I want to divide it into groups of 12, and I have been asked to find that if I divide them into groups of 12, how many chocolates would be left over, that is the remainder when this large number of chocolates is divided by 12. This is what the problem was, and we know from the multiplication, the property of multiplication of congruences, that the division or the remainder of the multiplication is nothing but the multiplication of the remainders. So 44 when divided by 12 gives me a remainder of 8, and 113 when divided by 12 gives me a remainder of 5. So my answer is, I have to say remainder, okay, remainder. I am only interested in remainder term here. So my answer becomes, this is really congruent to 40 mod 12, which is congruent to 4 mod 12. So 4 chocolates would be left over. And again, the problem, the thing, the key step which really simplified this entire problem was this one. Here we reduce the large numbers right here to smaller numbers by only considering their remainders when divided by 12. Moving on, this is the most important theorem. This is the most important property of congruence. And what does it say? Let's look at the property. We know that 9 is congruent to 2 mod 7. And this property is telling us that if I raise this 9 to the same power, this congruence would hold as long as I raise the other side to the same power. Let's see if this works. So this works, right? And the reason why this works is very simple, right? Because we already understand that multiplication, so remainder of the multiplication, so 9 into 9, the remainder is really same as the remainder, is the same as the multiplication of the remainders. So the remainder of this multiplication is really same as the multiplication of the remainders. And this is 9 square. So this property of congruence really comes from the multiplication property. So it's just an extension of the property of multiplication of congruence. But this is really powerful, okay? And we'll use it in just a second. So let's take this example. If you notice, our numbers are really becoming large. Right? This is like very, very large number. And if we were to really solve this, we'll get stuck. Again, last digit, we have to realize, as soon as we see last digit, last two digits, last three digits, we have to understand that last digit is nothing but remainder when divided by 10. Last two digits are nothing but remainder when divided by 100. Last three digits are nothing but remainder when divided by 1000. So this is something that we have to realize. So this is nothing but what the problem is. The problem is asking us to find the remainder when this large number is divided by 10. So the way we solve it is, first thing we write is 17 is congruent to 7 mod 10. This we know is correct because 17 leaves a remainder of 7 when divided by 10. Now I raise both the sides to power of 16. I can do that because of the exponentiation theorem. So this congruence definitely holds. Right? So what is this telling me? It's telling me that when this large number is divided by 10, I will get this large number as remainder, which is really not so helpful. But we can quickly simplify this. The way I do it is, I write this 7 raised to power 16 as 7 into 7 raised to power 8. I can do that. Mod 10. And then I further simplify this as 49 mod 10. Again, the step that I write, right? I don't have to really write it in when I'm solving it in real exam. But what I do is, I say 49 is congruent to minus 1 mod 10. Okay. So I don't have to really write it in the exam, but what is this telling me? This is telling me that 49 is one short of being fully divisible by 10. That is correct, right? Because 49 is of course one short. If I add 1 to 49, then I get a result. Then this number 50 is fully divisible by 10. So I can write it. Then I raise both the sides by 8. And this is nothing but 1 mod 10. Okay. So, in real exam, I can really omit all these steps, and from here, I can simply write this is congruent to 1 mod 10, right? So, I should be able to realize that this 49 is really minus 1 mod 10, and then go from here to here, and this should just be one step in the real exam. So, the answer is that when this large number is divided by 10, the remainder is 1, or the last digit of this is 1. Now moving on, we take another similar example. Again, I have some very, very large number. Here the number has exponent of exponent of exponent of exponent. So if I were to really solve this, it would take me forever. So we'll not even go there. We'll use our beautiful shortcut trick. So the first thing I do is I write 6 is congruent to minus 1 mod 7. And remember, if you can write minus 1 here, it would always simplify your problem. So write 1 and minus 1 as much as possible. So write smaller numbers here, and that would simplify your life. Okay. This is the first thing. What is this saying? This is saying 6 is one short of being fully divisible by 7, which is correct. So then what do? I raise this 6 to the power of 6 and minus 1 to the power of 6 and I get a result of 1 mod 7. So the thing to realize here, the first thing that we realize here is, even without writing this 6, the thing that we realize here is this minus 1, if raised to an even power, would give me 1, and this minus 1, if I raise it to odd power, it would give me minus 1. Now this power of 6 here in the question, 6 raised to power 6 raised to power 6 is even. So from here, I should straight away be able to say that 1 would be the remainder. Right? So from right here, I should be able to say that 1 is the remainder. So look how simple this problem became. So the congruence, the property of congruences, especially the exponent property, really helps us simplify the problems substantially. Moving on, there is this one more property of congruence, and it is the division property. I am just covering it here for the sake of completeness. You're not really recommended. I don't really recommend that you ever use this property. You always apply division if you ever have to. Most likely you wouldn't have to, but if you ever have to apply division, you always go back to the basic principle. I'll explain what do I mean by basic principle. So if I keep on doing what I have been doing for addition and multiplication, and I divide this congruence by 2, what would I do? I would divide 10 by 2. I would divide 2 by 2, and I would say this is good to go. I would say that this is the answer. But of course, this is incorrect, because 5 divided by 8 is not really 1. So this is wrong. So we can say that this is wrong. So division doesn't work like this 100%. Well, now let's look at what happens here. If I apply the same thing here, what happens? 12 is congruent to 2 mod 5. This seems to be correct. So what is the thing here? What is the problem here? What am I missing? This works for some reason, but this doesn't work. And the reason, my friends, is let's write this, let's convert this congruence sign, this three line sign to equal to. What can I say? 10 is equal to 8 into 1 plus 2. Now, when I divide this equation, this is an equation now because there is an equal sign, by 2, I have to divide each term. And when I divide 10 by 2, I get number 5. When I divide this 8 into 1, this 1 does not have any, factors of 2. And this 8 has a factor of 2. Right? This 8 is 2 into 2 into 2. So, this 8 has 2 as a factor. So, when I divide this term by 2, I get 4. This 8 becomes a 4 and this 2 becomes a 1. So, this congruence, when I divide this congruence by 2, I should really be dividing this number also. Right? And that was the problem. And now, I get correct answer. Here, if I write it similar to this, and I divide everything by 2, each of the terms by 2, 2, what do I get? 12. Notice that this 5, unlike here, this 5 does not have 2 as factor. So, I cannot remove anything from 5 when I divide by 2. So, I have to remove thing from here. And this term 4 does not appear anywhere in this equation. This term 4 is useless as far as this congruence is concerned. The 4 here is really the 4 here is the remainder term here. This 4 and this 4 are same. But this 4 is not considered here. And when I divide by 2, this term when I divide by 2, I cannot divide anything from 5. I have to remove something from this term. But this 5 is carried as is. So this congruence really becomes like this. So this equation comes down to this congruence, which is correct. And the reason is, the number with which I am dividing does not share any common factor with the mod term, the term inside the mod, in this case 5. So, 5 and 2 are coprime, and that is why I can just divide these two numbers by 2 and get away with it. Whereas here, because this term, the term inside the mod, has a common factor with the term with which I am dividing, namely 2, I have to really divide this term also. And that is why the division becomes very complicated, and I always recommend that you go back to the first principles to really understand what is happening when we divide. So now there is another small property. We can combine congruences in certain way. This is like really simple property of congruences. Notice that so far in exponentiation, addition, subtraction and all of those properties that we have discussed so far, the congruences we were able to combine had the same term inside the mod sign. Now, this is the only property which would allow us to combine the congruences with different things inside the mod sign. Suppose that I have to find a number, or I have to find numbers which are congruent. So, this number n has two properties. It is congruent to 2 mod 3 and it is congruent to 2 mod 7. That is, it leaves a remainder 2 when divided by 7 and it leaves a remainder 2 when divided by 3. I can always combine these congruences with same remainders, right, by using the LCM of the terms inside the mod sign. Which is nothing but 2 mod 21, because these are coprimes, so I can simply multiply them to find the LCM. So this is the only property where we were able to combine the congruences even when the terms inside the mod were different. This is simple. So now let's move on and take a slightly complicated example, a complicated word problem, and let's try to solve it. So I have 3 professors who begin their lectures on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, right? And then subsequently their subsequent lectures would be after gaps of 2 days, 3 days and 4 days. So first of all, they begin their lectures on different days, and then they would take lectures on different days after gap of different days, 2 days, 3 days and 4 days respectively. There are no lectures on Saturday. So in this university, Saturday is a holiday, so there are no lectures on Saturday. And we are being asked that After how many days will the professors omit the lecture together? That is, after how many days all of these professors will have a lecture on a Saturday, and they will be together, they will have a lecture on Saturday, and they will be forced to omit that lecture. So that is what we are being asked. So let's say that the number of days is n. Let's draw a small diagram and see what properties this n has to have. So again, we'll draw the diagram of our days of the week that we used in the days of the week calculation. 5, 6, okay. So this one, again, I'm considering 0 to be a Sunday, 1 to be a Monday, and so on and so forth. This is a Tuesday, Wednesday. Okay. So the first thing to notice here is the first professor took the first lecture on Monday, and subsequent lecture of the first professor would be on Wednesday, then Friday. Right. So this is how it would work. Saturday they would omit, and then Monday again. So all the days when this professor takes a lecture, all the days when this professor, the first professor, takes a lecture, what are the property of that day? That day leaves a remainder 1 when divided by 2. So this, the days on which the first professor takes a lecture leaves a remainder 1 when divided by 2. Similarly, let's take the second professor as an example. So the second professor took a lecture on Tuesday, and then he took a lecture on after 3 days, right? So 5 when divided by 3 gives me a remainder of 2. Of course, 2 when divided by 3 gives me a remainder of 2, right? So since he started after on the 2 here, and then we are adding 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, and then we are adding multiples of 3, right, to find the next lecture day. The lecture day of the second professor would always give me a remainder of 2 when divided by 3. And the reason why I use the same n is because on this day, on the nth day, all of these professors have a lecture, and it's also Saturday on that day. So on nth day, this professor has a lecture, this professor has a lecture. Because the first professor has a lecture on the nth day, the remainder when this n is divided by 2 has to be 1. Because the second professor also has a lecture on the nth day, the n divided by 3 has to have a remainder of 2. And similarly, because The third professor also has a lecture on the nth day. The remainder, when n is divided by 4, has to be 3. And the reason why, again to explain this last case, he started on Wednesday, the third professor started on Wednesday. Wednesday is 3 here, and from 3 he would take lecture every fourth day. So every day he has a lecture, the 4, the terms of 4, the multiples of 4 would cancel out and we will get 3 as remainder. So far it is clear. Now the last property, this is Saturday. Last thing, the last equation, the last equivalence, the last congruence that we will write here is of a Saturday, because we know that n also has to be a Saturday, and all Saturdays have this property that they leave a remainder of 6 when divided by 7. Very simple. So with these 4 congruences, I go on with these 4 congruences. The first thing, I can simplify all of these congruences. The first thing is to realize that 1 minus 2 is minus 1, 2 minus 3 is minus 1, 3 minus 4 is minus 1, 6 minus 7 is minus 1. That is, this number is one short of being fully divisible by 2, it is one short of fully divisible by 3, one short of being fully divisible by 4, and same thing for 7. So what can I write? I can write that mod 2, it is also congruent to minus 1, mod 3, it is also congruent to minus 1, mod 4, it is also congruent to minus 1, mod 7. Now using the last property of combining congruences, what can I write? This is nothing but minus 1 mod LCM of these numbers. Right? So LCM of these numbers is 7 into 4 into 3. Okay. So my number is 1 less than being fully divisible by 84, or it is equal to 83. So the 83 is the smallest number n which would satisfy all of these congruences. And let's check, 83 when divided by 2 gives me a remainder of 1. When it's divided by 7, elevens are 77, and 77 it gives me a remainder of 6. So correct, this is indeed looks correct. So I was able to solve this problem very simply by using the properties of congruences. So there is also a concept of multiplicative inverse. We will discuss this in the next or subsequent classes, maybe not in the next class. And what does this tell me? It tells me that two numbers A and B, for every number A, right, and B, if multiplication of these two numbers gives me a remainder of 1 when divided by n, then B is the multiplicative inverse of A mod n, and A is the multiplicative inverse of B mod n. So this is just a definition that A and B are multiplicative inverses of each other mod n. So we have to find multiplicative inverse and how to use multiplicative inverse, their application, we would discuss in subsequent classes. This is just an introduction. For sake of completeness, I wanted this to be here. So here is a summary. Here is a summary of all the properties of congruences and how can we use them to simplify our questions. Remainder of sum is sum of remainders, simple. Remainder of differences, so A minus C divided by mod n, what would be the remainder? it would be simply the difference of the remainders when A is divided by N and C is divided by N. That is what this thing is telling me. Similarly, remainder of product is same thing, is congruent to product of remainders. Now, division, I told you that sometimes we have to change this term inside, the inside term also, the term inside the mod. And when this term has to be divided by the GCD, the HCF or the GCD of N, the term inside mod, and the number with which I am dividing. So, and other numbers get divided similar to the other problems, other properties. And again, the exponents, I can raise the both these terms to the same power, and the result would be equivalent or congruent. So again, remainder of exponent is exponent of remainders, and this is really important. This is really important property. So with this, we end this lecture on congruences, introduction to congruences. In the subsequent lectures, we would discuss the Euler and the Fermat's little theorem. Right? These are really important for for a class of aptitude problems. And then we'll discuss Wilson's theorem. This is not so important, but it should still be. It might still come become useful. And people who use these theorems are able to solve these some of the aptitude questions really quickly. So if you are interested in knowing these theorems, then please subscribe to Examiner's channel. If you have any questions or any doubts or any comments or corrections, please feel free to add the comment below the video. Till then, good luck and practice. Thank you.